Okay, so today we are going to talk about a homology and a cohomology. So from assignment one, we know that, okay, on computers, all the shapes are represented by triangle mesh. So here we show a complicated geometric surface, okay, from the sculpture Michelangelo, King David. Then this one actually is represented by growing many, many small triangles coherently. So such that the surface has inside the outside. So the normal is pointing outside. Okay, for each triangle, the three vertices are sorted counterclockwise with respect to the normal vector. Okay. Then on computer, we use a half-edge data structure to represent this kind of 3D geometry image, okay? So this is a one triangle mesh. So we see the mesh has a vertices, okay, also edges and faces. So each face has a three half edges from a loop. Then each half edge is attaching to one face, also attaching to one edge. So each edge has two vertices, okay? Each half edge has one target vertex and one south vertex. So then everything can be represented using this kind of half edge data structure. So the central class is a half edge. So each half edge has one pointer to the target vertex, one pointer to the attached face, one pointer to the edge. So each edge has two half edges, each face pointing to the first half edge. Each vertex pointing to one half edge. Okay. Then all the half edges form loops. So each half edge has one pointer to the next half edge and one pointer to the previous half edge. So then we use this data structure coherently to represent the surface. Okay. 今天呢，我们主要讲这个上下同调理论。然后，通过我们第一次作业，我们可以看到。 在机身机上，所有的曲面都表示成三角网格。这边是米开朗基罗大胃王的那个雕塑啊，扫描之后得到的三角刨分。那这个曲面的话，有内部有外部，然后曲面的法向量的话呢，是由内部指向外部。每一个三角形，它三个顶点的话呢，关于法向量是逆时针排列。那么在程序中，我们用所谓的半边结构来表示这种三角刨分。
哎，那这个半边结构的话呢，主要是为了表达三角网格。三角网格的话有顶点，然后有边有面，然后每个面的话呢，有三个带方向的半边，形成一个圈。然后的话呢，每个半边，粘到一个面里面，同时也粘到一个边上。所以的话呢，整个的数据结构是以这个半边这个 class 为中心的概念。 所以每根半边的话呢，有一个指针指向它的顶点 ，OK， 指向它的这个目标顶点，然后有一个指针指向它所在的这个面，有一个指针它所在的这个边儿，每个边呢有两个指针指向左右两个半边，然后每个面的话有一个指针指向它的第一个半边，每个顶点的话呢有一个指针指向以它为目标顶点的某一个半边。 然后所有的半边的话呢，构成很多圈儿，所以它每个半边它有个指针指向下一个半边，有一个指针指向它前面的这个半边，所以这是曲面三角刨分的这个数据结构。那么利用这个曲面的三角刨分，我们可以定义所谓的单纯同调，单纯的上下同调。 Okay, so we have learned surface topology theorem. Then we see the number of handles is called the genus. So this model has a zero genus. This one is a genus one. So this model is a genus two. This model has a three genus. Okay, also surfaces have boundaries. So this one has one boundary. This one have a three boundary, but the genus one. Okay, this is a Costa minimal surface. So for oriented surface, we're using the genus and also the number of boundaries to represent the topology. Then we can define connective sum. So here we show given to tori. So we remove a disk from tori, then glue both of them along the boundary of the disk. We form a genus 2 surface. And now oriented surfaces can be represented as a direct sum of tori. So using connective sum, we can build this kind of genus 8 surface. Okay. 我们学过这个曲面拓扑。 我们知道可定向曲面的话呢，可以用它这个环柄的数目来进行分类。所以这个曲面的话呢，它没有环柄，所以奎格为零。这个曲面的话呢，它有一个环柄，奎格为一。这个曲面的话呢，有两个环柄，所以奎格是二。这个曲面的话有三个环柄，所以奎格是三。那对于有边界曲面的话呢，我们还可以算它有几个边界。这是奎格为零的曲面，有一条边界。 这是奎格为一的曲面，有三条边界，这个曲面特别有名，叫 Costa 极小曲面。如果我们在空间固定三条边界，罩上一个肥罩膜，这个肥罩膜使得边界达到最小，被称为极小曲面。那么在数学界的话，有一个很长时间的那个 open 的问题，就说欧式空间中极小曲面拓扑是不是都是平庸的？Costa 的话呢，他是个巴西数学家。 然后它呢，是猜到了这个解的一部分，八分之一上，在计算机上把它实现出来。所以这个计算机的技巧的话，对于很多数学问题就有本质的一个帮助作用。OK， 那我们以前定义了连通和，这边给了两个环带，轮胎是吧？每个轮胎上我们去掉一个 disk， 然后沿着这个disk 边界把它粘起来，得到一个奎格为二的曲面。 那么用这种方法的话呢，我们可以把八个轮胎粘成这个奎格为八的曲面。OK， for non-alternable surfaces. OK, so they are built from a projective plane. So this is a Mobius band, which is non-alternable. OK, and the projective plane is defined as all the straight lines through the origin in R3. So then each line will intersect the unit sphere by two points. Okay. So as we show here, so we have a unit sphere, okay, in R3. The center is the origin. So every straight line will intersect the sphere at one point. But if the line is parallel to the XY plane, the line will intersect two antipodal points on the equator. So therefore, if we glue the boundary, okay, by antipodal points, we will get a closed surface, which is the projective plane. So if we cut the plane, okay, through this radical, we can decompose the plane to the upper part and the lower part. The lower part is a disk. So the upper part actually is topological annulus. So here we draw the arrow. So the arrow gives us the gluing pattern. Basically, for each point here, we glue to the antipodal point here. For the point here, we glue to the antipodal point here. Okay, then we cut through this line, We deform A to a rectangle, we deform B to a rectangle. Okay, then we see this line, they have opposite direction. So we want to glue them. Then we move A to this part, then we flip A such that okay, these two lines are parallel. Okay, then we can glue. Through this line, we get a strip. And here we see we glue left side to the right side. We need a twisting, okay, before the gluing. After twisting, we glue them together. We get this Mobius band. Okay, so this shows that the projective plane equal to the Mobius band glue with disk. Okay, so here we see that the Mobius band has only one boundary, so the radical here. So the disk has one boundary. We glue the disk with Mobius band along this boundary. Okay. 对于不可定向曲面，所以这个是莫比斯带是吧？不可定向的。那么我们定义所谓的摄影平面，所以摄影平面就是三维空间中所有过原点的直线。然后的话呢，我们用球面把它参数化。比如在三维空间中，我们有一个半球。 然后呢，这个半球的话呢，每条直线和这个半球有一个交点。如果直线和 xy plane 平行，直线和这赤道有两个交点，在这个对镜点上是这两个交点。所以的话呢，如果我把这半球赤道上对镜点粘起来，得到一个封闭的流形，就是摄影平面。那我们把这个摄影平面的话呢，从下边通过红线拉开，是吧？分成两部分。下边的话呢是一个标准的圆盘，上面呢是个环带，画在这里是吧？环带的话，这个箭头在这个圆弧上表明它的粘贴的方法，每个点和它的对应点粘起来，然后我把这环带从左边砍一刀，右边砍一刀是吧？然后在砍断的地方的话呢，加上箭头表示这个粘贴的方式。然后呢，我们把这 A 变形成一个长方形，把 B 变成另外一个长方形，然后呢，这个 A 上面这个这条边要和 B 的下面这条边粘起来，我们把 A 挪到下边来，那这条边的话，方向相反，所以我们把这 A 这个翻转一下，翻转之后的话呢，这个左边变到右边，右边变到左边，我们看这个相对的这个边的话是平行的，就把它粘起来，得到一个长条是吧？左侧的话呢，这个箭头和右侧箭头给出粘贴的方式，所以我们需要把这个整个这个枝条给它扭曲一下，然后粘起来，这样就得到了一个莫比斯带。所以这就意味着投影平面的话呢，摄影平面它等于莫比斯带和这个圆盘粘起来得到的流形。我们知道这莫比斯带的话呢，它只有一条边界，然后的话呢就是这条红色的边界，这个圆盘的话也有只有一条边界，所以他们俩沿着这个粘起来，同样边界粘起来之后的话，得到摄影平面。Okay, then we can consider the fundamental group of the projective plane. So from this figure, we see that, in the middle of Mobius band, there is a closed curve, we denote it as a gamma. But from this figure, we see that, so the red curve is the boundary of Mobius band, which equal to 2 gamma or gamma square. So therefore, we get the boundary equal to gamma square. So when we glue with the disk, then the boundary on the disk can shrink to point. So therefore, gamma square equal to E. So using von Kappen-Seifert theorem, we see that, the projective plane, the fundamental group equal to gamma and E. So therefore, it is a Z2 group. Modulus 2 group. 那下面的话呢，我们可以算一下，这个摄影平面的它的一个基本群。我们看，这个莫比乌斯带的话呢，它中间有一个封闭曲线，我们记成伽马。那么通过这个图的话，我们可以看到，这个伽马的平方等于红色的边界。然后的话呢，粘完之后的话呢，这个边界在这个圆盘上能缩成一个点，所以根据这个 von Kappen-Seifert 的定理的话呢，我们得到摄影平面它的基本群只有两个元素，一个是 gamma， 一个是 E， 所以它是 Z2 群，是摩尔的这个群。So then we can see the fundamental theorem for surface topology.So given a closed kinetic surface, and it can be represented as a finite sum or toroid or sphere or finite number of disjoint disk removed cross caps glued in their places. So therefore, we can write down the surface equal to S1, kinetic sum S2 to kinetic sum Sg. So here, each Si is a torus if surface is orientable, otherwise,SI is a projective plane. Okay, so this gives us the fundamental topological theorem for surface. 这样的话呢，我们可以得到曲面的这个topoplay 的基本定理。就说曲面的 topo 的话呢 ，okay， 可以分解成一系列这个曲面的连通和。这个每个 SI 的话呢。如果是轮胎的话，当前紧张这个曲面是可以定向的。如果曲面不可定向的话呢，这个 SI 可以换成是摄影平面。 Okay, then we come to the definition for triangle mesh. So basically, we define a triangulation for the surface. Okay, then each face is counterclockwise oriented with respect to the normal of the surface. Then each edge has two opposite half edges. And based on triangulation, we can define the concept for simplex or complex and a simplex or simplex. So basically, a vertex is called a zero-dimensional simplex. One half edge is called one-dimensional simplex. One oriented face is called a two-dimensional simplex. Okay, and one three-dimensional tetrahedra, okay, with orientation, is called a three simplex. So in general, a k-dimensional simplex is a convex hull for k plus one vertices. So v naught, v one, to v k are the vertices in Euclidean space. Okay, then if we calculate their convex hull, okay, the convex hull is determined by okay this simplicial simplex. Okay, we using bracket v naught, v one, okay, to v k to represent this simplex. Okay, then we can glue simplex together to form a complex. So basically, a simplicial complex is a union of simplices. So satisfy two conditions. So if a simplex sigma belong to a big sigma, then all the facets for small sigma belong to the big sigma. So if there are two simplices, okay, in the complex, so either they do not intersect or their intersection is also a common facet of the two simplices. So here we see we have a tetrahedron, we glue one triangle with this edge, another triangle with this edge, and one edge, okay, or simplex with this vertex. But here, this is not complex, because we have two simplices. So the intersect at this part is not a common facet between them. So 我们刚才看到在计算机上曲面被表达成三角网格，是吧？就是有一个曲面，然后我们在上面定义了一个三角刨分。每个面的话呢，它的顶点是逆时针排列，所以的话和这个曲面的法向量构成右手系，是吧？ 每个边的话呢，它有两个相反的这个半边。那么把这个概念推广，这高维流行的这个三角刨分，被称为单纯复形，是吧？单纯复形的 building block 就是这种三角形，是吧？那么曲面上这个顶点被称为零维单纯形，每个半边的话呢被称为一维的单纯形，每个面的话呢被称为二维的单纯形。 然后每个 tetrahedron 四面体，带有定向，是吧？被称为是三维的单纯形。然后的话呢，在欧式空间中，有 k 加一个顶点 v 零 v 一到 v k。那么这些顶点呢，它的突包被称为是一个 k 维的单纯形，用这个括号是吧 v 零到 v k 来表示。那么单纯复形的话呢？ 就是很多单形的一个并集，满足两个条件。如果有一个单纯形属于这个复形，那么这个单纯形的所有的面是吧？有 tetrahedron 它有四个面是吧？每个三角形有三个面，三维的一维面是吧？每个 edge 上有两个面，所以的话呢，它所有的面呢也属于这个复形。如果有两个单形的话呢，属于这个复形，它们或者彼此不交，或者它们交的话呢，是一个共同的面。 所以我们看左侧这个，有一个四面体，然后呢，我们沾上两个三角形，沿着一条边，又沾上一个一条边上，沿着一个顶点。所以左侧这是一个单纯复形，右侧的话呢，我们有两个三角形，那沾的时候的话呢，它们这个交集并不是它们俩的面，所以右侧的话呢，并不是一个单纯复形。哎，左侧是单纯复形，所以从这里看到的话，这个单纯复形的概念。 比这个流行要宽泛很多，更加general，是吧？所以这个上下同调的话呢，实际上是定义在这个单纯形上的。 Okay, and so once we have defined symmetrical complex, then we can define the so-called chain and the chain space. So the linear combination for all chain surfaces, okay, is called a K-chain. So basically, sigma sub I here is a simplex, okay? And lambda I here is an integer. So we take the formal summation, we define chain, okay? Now all the K-dimensional chain form a linear space, which is called a K-dimensional chain space, using C sub K to represent. So here we see on the David head, we have one chain here, so the yellow curve here, so formed by the sequence half edges. So the coefficients for each half edge here equal to one. For other half edges, coefficient equal to zero. Then here we see several surface patch, okay? The red one, green one, blue one, and the yellow one. So each of them is called a two chain. Basically, for all the triangles, okay, on this green patch, the coefficient equal to one, otherwise equal to zero. So here we define the two chain here, okay? Okay, 有了这个单纯复形之后的话呢, 我们可以定义所谓的下链或者链, 是吧? 每个链的话呢, 是同为单纯形的一个线性组合, 然后线性组合的系数的话呢, 都是整数。 这边我们看一个一链, 是吧? 是这条黄色的一个路径, 它有一系列的一个半边这个组成, 每个半边对应的一个系数是正一。 那不在链上的这些, okay, 这些半边的话呢, 对应系数为零。 右侧的话呢, 我们定义的是, 二链, 所以每个二链的话, 是一个 surface patch, 是吧? 比如说这个绿色这个二链, 它有很多三角形组合起来, 每个三角形对应系数是正一。 然后的话呢, 其他这个, 不在这些二链上这三角形对应系数为零, okay? Okay, then we can define boundary operator. So basically, we can take the boundary for a simplex. Okay, and for chains, basically we just linear extend the definition of a boundary, okay, on each simplex. So here you see, given a vertex, so the boundary for vertex equal to nothing, equal to zero. So here we have half edge from P to Q. So the boundary operator acting, okay, on half edge equal to the target vertex minus the source vertex. So here we have two simplex. So the boundary is given by three half edges and go through its boundary. And here we have a tetrahedra. If we're taking the boundary, so the boundary is given by four oriented triangles here, okay? And then in general, so if we have a n-dimensional simplex, we take the boundary operator, so which give you a k minus one chain. So each time we remove one vertex from the simplex. Okay, if we remove the s vertex, then we multiply minus one to the power I as a linear coefficients. So this gives us a consistent definition for boundary. So here we see two chain on David head. So if we take the boundary, we get one chain. So the one chain gives us the boundary for the surface. 然后的话呢, 我们可以定义所谓的边缘算子。 Okay, 这个非常的符合直觉, 是吧? 这个顶点, 它对应的边缘算子就是零, 然后这个半边的边缘算子的话呢, 等于中点减起点。 然后每个三角形的这个半边结构的话呢, 等于, 它的这个三角形等于三个, 它的三个半边。 这个有一个四面体, 它的半边结构的话, 是它对应的四个面, 四个三角形。 那这边我们看, 如果我们有一个 n-位的单纯形, 顶点是 v0, v1, v2 到 vn, 那它的边缘的话呢, 就是每次我去掉一个顶点, 把第二个顶点去掉, 然后前面乘以 负1的i次幂, 把这些加起来得到一个 n-1位的链, 所以它每个 n-位单纯形, 它的边缘是一个 n-1位的链。 那这边的话呢, 我们有一个 二链, 我们对这二链求半边结构，那么最后我们得到的是右边红色这些这些一链是吧？这些链给出这些二链的边缘。OK，内部这些边的话呢，在求边缘结构的时候，它们相抵相消 余下的都是这个曲面上的边界。Then we can define a closed chain, okay, and an exact chain. So if we have one chain, recall one chain is closed. So if the boundary operator acting on this chain equals zero, okay, basically, given one chain, if we say this one chain is closed, it must be a loop, okay? So here we see on David head, we have this one chains. So they are closed loops. So if we're taking the boundary operator, then every vertex, okay, on this loop will be counted twice. So once as a target point for some half edge, once as a source point for some target edge. So therefore, total summation, they will cancel out, we get a zero. But here we have two paths. Okay, if we're taking the boundary, then the boundary for this path equal to the target vertex minus the real source vertex, okay? So therefore here, the one chains are not closed, but here the one chains are closed. 这边呢，我们定义所谓闭链的概念，说如果有一个下链是吧，那么在边缘算子作用下它等于零，我们说它是闭的。那这边的话呢，我们看，这个在曲面上有两啊，有一些one chain 是吧，有一些一下链。那这边一下链的话呢，都是封闭的曲线是吧，都是圈。那么它的边缘的话是空的，这个下链上每个顶点，在求边界算子的时候呢，出现两次，一次是作为目标是吧，一次是作为原顶点，所以它们彼此相抵相消，等于零。这边的话呢，我们有两个非封闭的路径在曲面上，也是 one chain。那么这个边缘算子作用上之后的话呢，我们得到它的终点，减掉它的起点。所以这边不是 B 点，这边是 B 点。Okay, then we can define something called an exact chain. So basically, given a K-chain, which is called an exact chain, if there exists a K plus one chain, sigma here, the boundary of sigma equal to gamma. Then we say gamma is a K-dimensional exact chain. So here we see we have 2D.Patches here, which is two chain. So the boundary of two chain must be one chain. Okay, you can see that the boundary chains must be closed. So this kind of chains are called exact one chains. But here we see on the kitten model, there's a closed chain. But then this chain is not the boundary of anything. So then this is a closed but non-exact one chain.然后我们可以定义所谓的恰当链是吧，或者叫边缘链。就说如果有一个 K 链伽马被称为是恰当的。如果存在一个 K 加一维的链 Sigma, 这个 Sigma 的边缘的话呢等于这个伽马。这边我们看的话呢，曲面上有很多 two chain, 是吧，很多二链。这个二链的边缘的话呢是一 chain, 被称为是恰当的。这里我们可以看到恰当的链的话都是封闭的。这个 2D surface patch 的边缘一定是封闭的曲线是吧，那这边的话呢，小猫的模型上我们有一个封闭的圈是吧，那这个封闭的圈的话呢，它不是任何一个二链的边界，所以它是闭的但不是恰当的。Then we can prove the following fundamental theorem. So the boundary of boundary is empty.Okay, so this can be done using very simple combinatorial argument. Okay, so namely, this shows all the exact chains are closed. Okay, but the inverse may not be true. Okay, so here we see we have two chains. So the boundary are closed one chains. And here on the kitten model, for this red curl, so it is the boundary for some 2D patch, which is exact. Okay.But then this loop is not. So this loop is closed, but not exact. 关于关键边界算子的话，有一个很基本的定理，叫边缘的边缘是空极，是吧？边的边为空。这就是说，所有这个恰当的链一定都是闭的。但是呢，这个逆命题不见得成立，说闭链不见得一定是恰当的。这边我们看 在这个曲面上有很多二点啊，每个二点的边界的话呢是封闭的一链，在这个小猫的模型上的话呢 OK 有不同的这个链是吧，一链啊，这边的话呢有个 2D patch， 它的边界的话呢是一个封闭的一链是吧，所以它也是一个恰当链。那这个圈的话呢它本身是封闭的，但它不是恰当的。Okay. Then the difference between the closed chains and the exact chains give us the topology of the surface. So basically, any closed one chains on the genus zero surface must be exact. But on the tower, there's some closed one chains which are not exact. 所以的话就说这个封闭链和恰当链之间的区别给出了曲面拓扑。比如说 QKV0 的曲面上所有的封闭链都是恰当的。但是在 QKV1 的曲面上有些闭链的话呢不是恰当的。OK, 这边我们可以看这个对位头 ,WD head, 是吧，它是 QKV0 的曲面。那它上面所有的闭链肯定都是恰当链是吧，这小猫上面它存在闭的但是非恰当的链，当然也存在这个闭的并且恰当的链是吧。那这句话这个表达起来就说这个边一定是圈是吧，圈不见得是边儿 ,OK, 这边代表 exact chains, 是吧，一定是圈代表 closed chains,OK,、okay? Then we can define a homology group, so basically, given a simple complex, so the case homology group is given by the quotient, OK, the kernel partial K divided by the image of partial K plus 1.Okay, so then this means that the homology group is given by all those kind of closed chains which are not exact. Okay, so two K chains are homologous. So if their boundary, so if they form a boundary of a K plus one chain sigma, okay, gamma one minus gamma two equal to the boundary of some sigma. Okay.这样的话呢我们可以定义所谓的下同调群。那么这个 K 维的下同调群的话呢它就是 K 维的 B 链构成这个群，然后呢磨掉了 K 维的这个恰当链构成的群。所以这个公式的话呢这个分子代表是 B 链，分母的话呢代表恰当链。这上面是圈下面是边是吧，圈和边的差别给出了这个同调。假如呢给定两个 K 链是 gamma1 和 gamma2， 我说它们彼此下同调，如果它们之差的话呢是某一个 K 加1维链的边缘是吧，就是 gamma1 minus gamma2 equal to partial K plus 1 sigma、okay. ，这样的话就给出了这个同调群的古典定义啊。Okay, using this definition, you can do a lot of topological tasks. So here we show one example to explain the idea for homology group. So here we have a genus 3 surface. Then we have three loops, gamma 1, gamma 2, and gamma 3. So if we slice the surface along three loops, okay, we get three two chains. One is a sigma 1, one is sigma 2.One is sigma 3. So here we see that the boundary of sigma 1 equal to gamma 1 minus gamma 2. So therefore, gamma 1 and gamma 2 are homologous. Okay. So this one we show that the boundary of sigma 2 equal to gamma 3 minus gamma 1 and plus gamma 2. Okay. So this shows gamma 3 is homologous to gamma 1 minus gamma 2.And here we see that gamma 3 is the boundary of sigma 3. So therefore, in homology group, gamma 3 equal to 0. Okay. 那这里的话呢，我们显示了一个例子来解释这个同调的思想。输入的话呢是一个 QKV3 的曲面，然后呢我们有三个 圈是 gamma 一、gamma 二、gamma 三。然后的话呢，我们沿着三个圈把曲面切开，切开之后的话呢，我们得到三个二链是吧？第一个二链是 sigma 一，第二二链是 sigma 二，第三个是 sigma 三。然后这个 sigma 一的话呢，我们看它的边界是 gamma 一减 gamma 二，所以的话呢 ，gamma 一和 gamma 二是同调的。sigma 二的话呢，它的边界是 gamma 三减 gamma 一加 gamma 二，所以的话呢 ，gamma 三和 gamma 一减 gamma 二是同调的。这边我们看，这个 sigma 三的边界是 gamma 三，所以 gamma 三是同调为零的。那这里我们看到这个同调的一个基本定义，是吧？Okay, so the relation between homology and homotopy can be explained as follows. So we know that the first fundamental group is non-abelian, okay? But the homology group is abelian. So given a non-abelian group, we can define something called a commutator, which is a normal subgroup generated by okay, this kind of Lie bracket. So given arbitrary two elements, okay, in pi 1,Gamma sub 1, gamma sub 2, we calculate their Lie bracket. All such kind of Lie bracket generated a subgroup, which is the commutator. The quotient group, okay, will make the whole quotient group to be abelian. So then that is the homology group. Then from this one, we see that, okay, fundamental group has more information than homology group.So the difference between their information is represented by this commutator. 所以我们知道这个基本群的话呢是不可交换的，然后的话呢同调群的话呢是可以交换的。因此的话呢，我们可以把一个不可交换的群变成可交换群，叫阿贝尔化。那就说我们在群中任取两个元素，gamma 一、gamma 二，然后算它们的离合号，那么这个所有这种锂括号的话呢，生成的这个子群被称为中心交换子。那原来的群的话呢，商掉这个中心交换子，得到就是一个阿贝尔群。那通过这个公式的话呢，我们可以看到，这个同调群的话呢，比同轮群的信息要少，它丢失的信息的话呢，就是这个中心化子这个群。OK， 那因为的话呢，这 H1 是阿贝尔化的，所以它非常容易计算。派1的话是非阿贝尔的，所以它计算比较困难。So therefore we see that because H1 is a abelian group, so it's very easy to compute. 派1 is a non-abelian, it's difficult to compute, but it has rich information okay, than H1. So here we explain the losing information.So here we see that if we draw this gamma in the middle, then actually gamma equal to A1 inverse. So in the fundamental group, gamma cannot shrink to point. You can capture the information for gamma. But in the homology group, gamma equal to zero. So therefore we lose the information for such kind of gamma. 这边的话呢，我们看一个奎格维尔的曲面，我们在腰上画一个圈是 gamma。那伽马的话呢，它等于 A1 和 B1 的这个锂括号，所以的话呢，在这个同轮群中的话呢，伽马是不能缩成一个点的，所以我们是能够得到伽马的信息，但是在同调群中，伽马等于零，所以我们失掉了伽马的信息。Okay, then there's something called the Poincaré dual, which is really useful.Here we define a planar triangulation, then we define the dual Voronoi diagram. So basically, for each triangle face, we calculate the circumcircle. Okay, then we put it circumcenter there. For each edge, if the edge connecting to two faces, we connect the corresponding circumcenter. And by doing this, we get the green cell decomposition. So,Each vertex on the triangulation become to a cell, okay, in the Voronoi diagram. So each face, okay, become to a Voronoi point. Then each edge, okay, become to a Voronoi edge. So therefore, we get the different cell decomposition for the same surface. And we can generalize this kind of duality to higher dimensional triangulation. Okay. So then by this duality, we can prove the following theorem. Okay, so given n-dimensional closed manifold M, then the k-dimensional homology group is isomorphic equal to the n minus k dimensional homology group. Okay. So for surface case, this means that H now is isomorphic to H2. Okay. So then this is information is very useful in practice.
那么这边的话呢, 我们定义这个三角剖分。 平面上有个三角剖分, 我们可以定义一个对偶的这个Voronoi diagram。 说每个三角形这里的话呢, 我们定义这个, YJ圆的圆心, okay? 然后的话呢, 如果有一条边和两个三角形相连, 我们把这两个三角形的这个, 外心相连。 得到一条边是吧？ 这样的话我们构造了一个对偶的图， 三角形的顶点， OK， 变成这个 Voronoi diagram 中的一个包浆， 然后的话呢， 这个三角形的每个面 变成 Voronoi 的一个顶点， 然后每条三角形的边 变成 Voronoi 的一条边， 所以同样的一个曲面， 我们得到两个三角剖分， 得到两个这个包浆分解， 一个是黑色的三角剖分， 一个是绿色的这个包浆分解。 那么我们计算同调群的话呢， 可以用这两个包相分解， 得到结果应该是一致的， 由此我们得到一个对偶的定理， 那就是说， 这边我们看， 这些可以向高维推广， 然后我们可以得到这样一个定理， 说有一个N维的流形， 然后它是封闭的， 那么它的K维的这个下同调群 和它的N-K维下同调群 彼此是同构， 在曲面上， 这就意味着0维的这个同调群和2维同调群彼此同构。 那么这个0维平面这个同调群的话 是等于z， 2维的话也等于z， 这个z意味着它只有一个 连同分支 kinetic component。 OK， 那h1的话呢 它等于z2g， g是这边是 genus。 So in order to compute homology group basis, we use something called a Swiss knob for integer matrix. So basically, the k dimensional chain space is a linear space. The k minus one dimensional chain space is a linear space. So the boundary operator, okay, is a linear operator. So therefore, this boundary operator can be represented as a matrix. Okay, so assume for k dimensional chain space, there are n sub k symplices, which is sigma 1 to sigma nk. Then we can write down the formula for this chain space. Then we can write down the boundary operator as a matrix. So basically, the ijth element in this matrix could be 0, could be positive 1, could be minus 1. Okay. Okay, so here we see that if the ice, k minus one dimensional simplex has no intersection with j's k dimensional simplex, then this number equal to zero. Okay, so if the ice k minus one dimensional simplex, is on the boundary of the sigma j here, the orientation, are consistent. Then we put a positive one here. So if sigma I is on the boundary of sigma j, but the orientation is opposite, then we put a minus one here. So therefore we can write down this sparse matrix. So every element is either zero, positive one, or minus one. Okay, then we can construct a linear operator we call combinatorial Laplace operator from CK to CK, which is given by partial k transpose multiply partial k plus partial k sub k plus one multiply partial k plus one transpose. Then we can claim
the eigenvectors corresponding to zero eigenvalue or this delta k form the basis of each k. Okay, so the eigenvalues and eigenvectors for this integer matrices can be calculated using a Smith norm. Okay, but here because the matrix are integer matrix, computing Smith norm is a highly difficult. It's a non-polynomial. OK, 那么用代数方法计算这个同调权的基底 OK, 可以归结为求这个矩阵的特征根和特征加量。那么我们知道这个 K 为链空间，还有它们都是这个线性空间，然后呢边缘算子的话呢是线性空间之间的这个线性算子，所以边缘算子肯定是矩阵，那么我们可以把这个矩阵明确的写下来。 我们看这个 C K 维的这个链空间，它的基底的话呢是所有 K 维的单形是吧？然后呢，那么这个矩阵，它的每项或者是零，或者是正一，或者是负一。如果第 I 个 K 减一 维的单形和第 J 个 K 维单形没有交集，那对应这项就是零。如果这个 sigma I 它在 sigma J 的这个边界上，并且定向一致，我们加上正一这边。 如果 sigma i， 这个在这个 sigma j 的这个边界上，并且定向相反，我们加上负一在这边。这样的话呢，我们得到一个很大的、很稀疏的矩阵。那这个矩阵的话呢，每一项都是明确的。然后我们构造一个叫组合的拉普拉斯算子。那组合拉普拉斯算子的话呢，就是 dk 阶边缘这个矩阵。 和它的这个准值相乘，加上 k 减一维的 k 加一维的这个边缘算子啊，它的准值乘以它本身，这样得到一个方阵，是从 k 链空间到 k 链空间是吧？那么这个方阵，它的特征根对应于特征零、特征值的特征根，构成了 dk 为下同调权的基底。那这个特征根的话怎么求呢？可以通过这个整数矩阵的 Smith。 范式是吧？Smith norm 来计算。那么，这个 Smith norm 计算的话，非常的昂贵。实际上它是不是多项式时间之内的复杂度，所以计算代价比较高昂。我们还是用我们自己那个第一次作业的组合方法算起来比较高效。So here, we can show one example for for cohomology group. So basically, suppose we have a triangle mesh, then for each half edge, we assign a number. So for this one, we assign positive 0.2.5 or 2.5, okay? Then for the opposite half edge, we give the same number, but take the negative sign here. So therefore, by assigning a real number for each edge, we define something called one cochain. So here we show a bigger triangulation. So for each edge, we assign number. I mean, for each half edge, we assign number. For the opposite half edge, we assign the negative number. Okay. So then we define one cochain. Now we can define the cochain space. So basically, we know the chain space, which is a linear space. Then all the linear functions, okay, on this chain space is called a cochain space. Then the one linear function is called one cochain, okay, or form, okay. Then, similarly, we can define co-boundary, okay, which is due to boundary operator. So basically, suppose omega is a k-form, okay, and then the co-boundary operator acting on omega give us a k plus one form, which is defined as omega acting on a boundary operator, okay. So here we can show some kind of example for this concept. Okay. So suppose we are given a triangulation, okay. Another one showing here. Okay. So here we have a big triangulation. Then we define a omega. So omega is one form. Okay. Then delta omega become to two form. Okay. So then given a face here, okay, then we have three half edges. Okay. So this is sigma face. Okay. Then this two form acting on this face is given by omega acting to the boundary of this face. Okay. Suppose this is E1, this E2, this E3, then this guy equal to omega E1 plus omega E2 plus omega E3. Okay. Then suppose we have a zero form. Okay. F is a zero form. Basically, it is a function defined on vertices. Okay. Then df, okay, become one form. Okay. And the df acting on one edge, vi vj equal to fvj minus fvi. So this gives you the definition for co-boundary operator. Okay.好，那这边我们来介绍上同调的概念。假设呢给了一个三角泡分，然后的话呢，我们为它的每个半边附上一个数，比如说这个红色半边我们附上了正零点二五，然后的话它的对偶边附上了负零点二五，那么这样的话我们得到了一个所谓的一型式或者一上链。OK，这边的话呢，我们为每个边上附上一个值。 那每个边它的半边给一个值，那相反的半边的话，这个值去负是吧？所以严格定义就说，这个 CK 是一个线性空间，那么这个 K 为下列空间上的任何一个线性函数被称为一个上链，有 K 为上链是吧？或者叫做一个 K 形式。那么所有的 K 上链构成空间也是个线性空间，被称为上链空间。然后的话呢，和边缘分子对偶。 我们可以定这个所谓这个上边缘算子是吧 ？co-boundary， 或者我们叫 微分算子也可以。那么的话呢，这边如果 omega 是一个 k form， 那么这个 d omega 的话呢，就变成一个 k 加1位的 form 是吧？那它这个这边我们给一个例子是吧？我们在平面上定一个三角泡分，然后呢？ 在这三角泡分上定一个一型式 omega， 那么这个 d omega 的话呢是个二型式是吧？这个 sigma 的话呢是个面儿，OK， 然后呢 d omega 作用在 sigma 上，它就等于 omega 作用在 sigma 的边缘上。那 sigma 这个面的边缘是 E1、E2、E3三个半边是吧？所以 d omega 作用在 sigma 上就等于 omega 11加上 omega 12加上 omega 13。 那如果我们定义一个所谓的零形式，f 它是定在顶点上的，那么 df 呢是个一形式，是吧？那 df 呢，它种在一个半边上，它就等于中点的值减掉起点的值，这样我们就定义了这个上边缘算子，是吧？也可以叫微分算子，这个 d 是吧？ Okay, similarly, we say a K form is closed. So if co-boundary operator acting on this K form equal to zero, okay, and then a K form is exact if there exists a K minus one form sigma, such that okay, omega equal to d sigma, okay. So because we can write down the action between form and the chain using this pair operator. Okay. Then the d omega acting on sigma equal to omega acting on the boundary of sigma. So this is the well-known Stokes theorem. From this Stokes theorem, we can get, okay, the co-boundary operator, okay, composed with co-boundary operator equal to zero. So this is due to the boundary equal to empty, okay? So here we can explain the Stokes theorem. Okay. Suppose we have a symmetrical complex here. Okay. From the symmetrical complex, okay, we can define one form. Okay. So omega is one form. Okay, and d omega become to two form. So by definition, d omega equal to, okay, the summation of the one form on the boundary half edges, okay, basically. And then if we take summation for all these two forms, okay, basically we do integration for d omega. So namely, we adding all the two forms together. Okay, then we see that for the inner edges, okay, the two values will cancel out. Okay? Once this come positive, once they come negative. So therefore, the only the exterior edges are left. So this one, this one, this one. So the omega value on these edges will be left. Okay. So therefore, we only need to count the value on these edges. So then therefore this one equal to, we taking the boundary omega, then we do evaluation using the one form here. So this is called Stokes. Okay, then by using Stokes, we know that third square acting on omega, okay, and take the pair of chain here. This one equal to third omega and partial sigma here. Okay, and this one equal to omega and partial square sigma here. So then we know that partial square equal to zero. So therefore this guy equal to omega acting on empty. So this one equal to zero. So therefore this implies third square equal to zero. Okay. Okay, 然后我们看的话呢, 有一个非常知名的这个所谓 斯托克斯定理, 就是如果给了一个 k 形式 omega, 然后给了一个 k 链, sigma, 那 k 形式作用在 k 链上, OK, 因为它是它上面的函数嘛, 可以写成这样一个 pair, 是吧? 那斯托克斯定理就说, 如果我对 omega 球 微分, 那等价于我对它这个下 链 球边缘算子, 那有时候我们可以推出来这个非分算子的平方恒等于零，是吧？这边我们可以给一个直观的解释，是吧？假如呢，你有一个平面的三角刨分，然后欧米伽是一个一形式，已经定义了，在每个半边上有个一形式，是吧？然后的话呢，d欧米伽是定义在这个每个三角形上的，它等于这个三角形三个半边之和，是吧？欧米伽三在三个半边上和，然后的话呢， 我们对这个two form进行这个求积分，相当于我们把这个三角形上这些数加起来。那我们看，这个每个半边上的omega值被算了两次，一次是正着算的，一次是逆着算的，所以它们相抵相消。最后没有被消掉的那个半边是吧，就是这个omega的边界。 就是图称的这个边界，所以我们就得到了这个斯托克斯定理。而 D 欧米伽关于这个图形式图称的积分，等于欧米伽关于这个图称边缘的积分。那么由此的话呢，我们来推一下这个，微分算子的平方恒等于零，所以 D 方欧米伽，作用在西格玛上。那么我们去掉一个，D 这边得到一个边缘算子是吧？然后呢，再去掉这个 D 这边得到边缘算子平方。因为我们知道边的边为空是吧？所以的话，这一项为零，这项为零的话呢，这边为零，整个为零，所以推出来这个两次这个 D 作用之后恒为零是吧？当然，用物理场论的语言就说这个梯度的旋量为零，然后的话，这个旋量场的散度为零是吧？可以这么定义。Okay, so therefore this shows that okay.Exact forms must be closed, okay? Because d square equals zero, but inverse may not be true. So if we have closed form, which may not be exact, okay? So the difference gave us the information for the original surface topology, okay? So then we can define the case cohomological group for the surface.Is given by this, the quotient between the closed form, okay, group, okay, with the image for the co-boundary operator here, or the exact forms, okay. So therefore, by this definition, we see that given two closed one form, we say if they are cohomologous, so if they differ by the gradient of zero form.So namely, omega 1 minus omega 2 equal to df. So then we can classify all the closed forms to classes. So all the classes form a linear space or linear group, which is the cohomology group. Okay. 所以和这个下同调类似，我们可以定义上同调啊。那上同调的话呢，就是 B 形式，然后呢和这个恰当形式的差别。所以右侧我们看这个分子 kernel 是吧？而它就是 B 形式，然后呢，分母的话呢，这个 image 得的 n minus one， 就是恰当形式。这 B 形式是一个线性子空间，然后它的 quotient 掉这个恰当形式之后的话，得到的它的补空间也是一个线性空间啊，被定义成这个单纯复形的 K 维的上同调群。比如说我给了两个 B 的一形式，我们说它们彼此上同调等价。当且仅当它们的差的话呢，是一个零形式的 D 是吧？就是欧米伽一减欧米伽二是一个恰当形式。这样的话呢，这个所有的上同调类 ，OK， 在加法一下成一个群，这个群被称为上同调群。所以这是上同调群的这个基本定义。Okay. And then from definition, we see that The homology group and the cohomology group, they are due to each other. So we can treat each element in a cohomology group as a linear okay, operator or linear functional for the homology group and vice versa. So therefore, we get this bilinear operator omega and sigma here. Okay, so then given homology group basis,Gamma 1 to gamma n, then we can calculate the dual cohomology group basis, omega 1, omega 2 to omega n, such that omega I acting on gamma g equal to coronet ij. 所以这个下同调呢和上同调群的话呢彼此相互对偶。就说这个每个上同调类可以看成是下同调群的一个线性算子或者线性函数。然后反过来也可以，每个下同调类的话可以看成是上同调群的一个线性算子，然后在类和类之间有个作用，可以写成这个双线性形式，是吧？这边的话，这个 omega 是一个上同调类，是吧 ？sigma 是个下同调类。如果我们给了这个下同调群的一个基底，那 gamma 一、gamma 二到 gamma n， 那么它对偶的上同调基底的话是 omega 一、omega 二到 omega n， 那么 omega i 作用在 gamma j 上等于 coronet ij。Okay, then we can define the symmetry mapping So here we have mapping between two disks. Okay, we see from left to right. Okay, so in reality, we calculate triangulation for the disk. Then the mapping basically map each vertex to vertex, each edge to edge, each face to a face. And the mapping is a piecewise linear map. Then this mapping is called a simulation map. If we come back to the definition, okay, suppose I'm an N simulation complexes. The F is a continuum mapping between them. Then for every simplex sigma on M, then its image is also simplex. Okay. then we call this mapping is a simulation mapping. So here, the image is a simplex, but the dimension might be reduced. For example, we map a face to an edge. We map an edge to a vertex. That is still simulation mapping. Okay. So there is a very classical approximation theory. So given two simulation complexes embedded in Rn, so given a continuous map between them, so given any error tolerance epsilon here, so then there exists a subdivision for M and N, so M tilde and N tilde. And we can find a simulation mapping between M tilde to N tilde, such that for any point P on the source, okay, and the image distance is less than epsilon. So here the distance is measured using Euclidean metric. Okay, so this means that we can approximate arbitrary continuous mapping to any precision by choosing a good translation. So this is the foundation for modern movie industry and the game industry. 下面我们介绍这个单纯映射的概念。首先我们可以看，我们把一个圆盘映到自身，是吧？那这个映射在计算机上是这样算的，我们把这圆盘进行三角刨分，然后这两个三角刨分是一致的，然后我们把左侧的每个顶点映到右侧的一个顶点，把左侧的每条边映到右侧的一条边，是吧？左侧的每个面映到右侧的一个面，就说把左侧的每个单形映到右边的一个单形，是吧？在单纯形内部，这个映射是线性的，所以我们用这个分片线性映射来逼近原来的这个映射。这种映射的话被称为单纯映射，是吧？所以我们来定义所谓的单纯映射，就是说给定两个单纯复形，然后呢，它们之间有一个连续的映射。那么对于栏上所有的单形，它的像也是个单形，但这边这个像的单形的话呢，的维数可能会降低。比如说我们把一个面降到一条边，然后呢把一条边映到一个点，是吧？那这样也是合理的。有一个非常基本的这个单纯逼近定理，就说给定单纯复形，它们嵌入在欧式空间里，然后的话呢有一个联系映射，那对于一切 epsilon 大于零，那么存在原来两个单纯复形的这个细分，是吧？M tilde 和 N tilde， 然后呢也存在这个细分之间的一个单纯映射 F tilde， 那么对一切这个 M 上的点，那么原映射的像点和 F tilde 像点之差是可以任意的小，是吧？那这边这个 norm OK 用的是欧式空间的距离来测量的，这就意味着任何光滑映射任何联系映射都可以用单纯映射以任意精度来逼近。这个单纯映射逼近定理的话呢，是整个现在的这个电影工业、游戏工业的基础。我们看到所有的这个 animation 上，都是用单纯映射来实现的。哎，然后的话呢，我们可以，来用这个下同调来定义这个一个映射的映射度，是吧？假设呢，M 和 N 呢都是封闭曲面，那我们知道封闭曲面的话呢，它的二维同调群就是整数啊，整数群 Z，OK、okay。然后的话呢，我们考虑 H2M 的它的一个生成源 M 是吧？这个生成源是什么呢？就是 M 上所有三角形求和的，得到的这个生成源是吧？那么 N 上的话，它也有个生成源， 是 N 上所有三角面片九何，是吧？然后有一个光滑映射，连续映射从 M 射到 N。那么这个映射的话呢，那我们可以用单纯复形来逼近 MN， 是吧？然后呢，用这个单纯映射来逼近这个 F。这样的话呢，那 F 的话呢，它把这个 B 链映成 B 链，边缘链映成边缘链，所以它就会诱导这个同调群之间的一个同态继承 F star。那么整数加群到整数加群所有的同态，它都可以写成把这个 z 是吧，这个整数乘以一个常数 c 呢也是整数是吧，这个 c 的话被称为这个映射的映射度是吧 mapping degree。 换句话说，我们有这个同态，这个同态的话呢，把 m 这个同调群的这个生成源映成 n 这边生成源乘以一个整数 c 啊，这 integer c 被称为这个映射的degree 啊。那么它的几何意义就是说，我们在目标上选一个点啊，看这一点的原像，然后这个原像的话呢，它覆盖这个像点多少次是吧，这个覆盖的这个代数次数，那这个东西的话被称为 mapping degree 是吧。我们可以画下图来解释一下这个概念啊。他说我们有两个封闭曲面 然后的话呢有一个连续映射，这是 M 是吧，这是 N， 假设这个是 N 啊，它映过来的话呢，那么它会包住它很多层是吧，这个比如说我们看局部它可能是这样包住是吧。 那我们看如果这边选一个点的话，这个点的话有几个原像，那在这个地方它这个包绕方式的话是正的正向覆盖是吧，那这点的话呢它是负向覆盖，这点呢又是正向覆盖是吧，这个的话又是正向覆盖，所以它一共覆盖了三减一是吧，等于两次是吧。那么我们再随便选一个点啊，这个点我们可以看正向覆盖两次啊，这个二的话呢就是这个 mapping degree 是吧，就是映射度的几何意义，就是我们把第一个曲面通过的映射，然后的话呢这个 wrap 是吧，缠绕在这第二曲面上，缠绕了多少层，这个代数乘数叫 mapping degree。 OK， so using a surface homology group we can define something called degree or mappingSo suppose M and N are two closed surfaces. So then we know that H2M is an integer group. Okay, then the homology group for N is also an integer group. Then suppose, the generator for H2M is given by this bracket M, which is formed by adding all the phase together, which is a closed two chain, non-exact. Okay.And similarly, the generator for H2N is this bracket N. So then we have a continuous map. We can approximate this continuous map by simplicial map, by subdividing M and N. Then the simplicial map maps boundary chains to boundary chains. They map closed chains to closed chains. So therefore, the mapping will induce a homomorphism between the homology groups, So therefore, this mapping maps the generator M to the generator N multiplied by some integer C there. So this integer C is called the degree of the map. Then geometrically, we can explain as follows. So suppose we have two closed surfaces M and N. We have F. Then F will cover N by several layers, the image of M. Then some part of the covering is positive, some part of the covering is negative. So this sign is given by the Jacobian. Okay. So basically we calculate the Jacobian matrix, at P, and we see whether this is a positive, or this is a negative, Then for every point, we choose the pre-image, then we're counting this covering Okay, local current degree, that we add them together, we get the total current degree, which is the degree or the mapping. Okay, and this one can be calculated algebraically, okay, as we explained. So this concept is pretty simple. Okay, then we can use this concept to prove a very famous theorem called the Gauss Bonnet. Okay, so here we show that, okay. The Gauss Bonnet. So suppose we are given a surface, okay. Okay, then at every point, we have a normal, NP, so this point P. Then we define Gauss map. Basically, G from surface to the Gaussian sphere. So then we map the normal to unit sphere, okay. Basically, we move this one here. Then this, okay, this is a parallel to the normal. Then this mapping is called the Gauss map. Okay. We map point P to the normal at point P. Okay. Then if we draw a small area at every point, so the image will be a small area on the sphere. Okay. So therefore, we calculate the ratio between this area. Suppose this is a small omega. Okay, then we calculate the area or omega. Okay. Then we calculate the area for the image of omega. Okay. Then we taking omega shrink to a point, point P. So this limit is called Gaussian curvature. Okay. Gaussian curvature. Okay. So namely, the Gaussian curvature is the Jacobian of the map. Okay, Jacobian. So therefore, so if Gaussian curvature is positive, that means we cover positively. Less than zero, we cover okay, negatively, basically. Okay. Then we can deform the surface, okay, to a canonical shape. Okay, like the one shown here. Then we consider a special direction, okay. Like the one shown here. So here we draw a genus 2 surface. Then we select special direction, horizontal. Then here you see we have one point. The Gaussian curvature here is positive. But at the handle, at this part, we also have another point. Okay, so here we have the third point. So in this neighborhood, the Gaussian curvature is minus, is a negative. The Gaussian curvature here is a negative, okay? So therefore, the degree of the map, okay, this Gauss map, equal to 1 minus genus, okay, for this special shape, okay. So then, so therefore, the surface will cover as 2, okay, so the total area for the image of the surface, okay, total area. This one equal to, okay, the area of the sphere, okay, multiply the degree of the map. So the total area for the sphere is 4 pi, so the degree is 1 minus g. So this is a 2 pi multiply the Euler number of the surface. Okay, then on the left hand side, how can we calculate the total area of the image surface? Basically, this should equal to we integrating, okay, on the original surface, okay. Then the area, okay, GDP, okay, divided by the area, DP, basically. Okay, so this one equal to, we do integration, the Gaussian curvature, okay, multiply DA. So therefore, eventually we get the famous formulation Gauss Bonnet, okay. Okay, this is the surface area, okay. Equal to 2 pi multiply the Euler number multiply the surface. But then if we are given, okay, very different shape, okay, basically we can do smooth deformation to map to this canonical shape, okay. Then this deformation is a smooth, okay. Then we know that then this value, the total, okay, integration divided by 2 pi, this one is an integer. So when we deform this surface, okay, little by little, okay, for example, we deform this one a little bit, and then this number will deform, okay. But then this number is an integer, so it doesn't change, okay. So this process is called homotopy. Basically, by combining homotopy argument and the mapping degree, we prove the Gauss Bonnet. Okay. So 这边的话呢，我们用映射度来证明非常知名的 Gauss Bonnet 定理。这是陈景生历史上头一次给出了一个内蕴的证明，是吧？就说有一个曲面，然后的话呢，我们把每个点用到它的法向量上。 这样就把曲面映成单位球，这个映射被称为高斯映射。然后的话呢，我们在这个点周围取一个小领域，omega， 它映到球面上就是 g omega 是吧？那么这个像的面积除以原像的面积，哎，我们把这区域逐渐缩小，最后里面只包含一个点的时候，它有极限。这个极限的话呢，被称为高斯曲率。OK， 所以高斯曲率的话呢，它实际是高斯映射的。 雅克比矩阵是吧？那么如果高斯曲率为正的话呢，这个覆盖是正向的；如果高斯曲率是负的话呢，这个覆盖是负向的。那我们取一个非常标准的形状是吧？把这曲面变形成一个标准形状，然后取一个特定的方向 ，OK， 水平方向。那我们看它这边有一个点，它的法向量的话等于给定这个水平方向。然后的话呢？ 它这个地方和这个地方都有两个点，是吧？这个点的这个法向量的话呢，也等于这个水平方向。那这个 handle 这个地方高斯曲率是负的，所以它只有一个地方高斯曲率是正，是吧？所以这个映射度的话呢，就等于一减掉亏格，它没有一个亏格就有一个 handle， 每 handle 上都有一个点，是吧？高斯曲率为负，然后这个点的法向量也是水平的。 这样就证明它的映射的 degree 的度呢是一减 g。那这样的话呢，这个曲面在高斯映射下的像会包绕这个单位球，我们算这个像的总面积。这像的总面积的话呢，这个正负相抵相消的，应该等于球面的面积乘以映射度，乘以层数是吧？这个映射这球的面积是4派，映射度的话呢是一减 g 是吧？这样我们就得到了 OK。 这样我们就得到了这个右侧积分值是4派乘以1.g 是吧？等于2派乘以欧拉伸映数。然后我们看它左侧的话呢，它左侧实际是我们要算包绕的话，这个像的面积是吧？那像的面积除以原来的面积等于高斯曲率，所以左侧等于高斯曲率乘以曲面的面积，在曲面上进行积分是吧？OK。 所以的话，我们就得到了，这个高斯曲率总积分是吧，等于2派乘以欧拉伸映数，哎，但这边的话呢，我们这个曲面的形状是取的一个基本形状，一个标准形状。对于任意形状的话呢，形状不标准，那怎么办呢？ 我们可以把这些形状就是这个缓慢的进行同轮变换，把它渐变成标准形状。那么左侧是高斯总曲率除以二派，右侧是个整数，是吧？那么你这边曲面形状渐变的时候，这个整数也在渐变，整数渐变的话就是不变，是吧？所以这就证明了，对于任何形状，如果它能和这标准形状同轮，这样的话呢，它的高斯总曲率等于欧拉沉影数，是吧？所以这个定理的话是陈颖申证明的定理。那左侧的话呢是微分集合，对吧？因为涉及到高斯曲率嘛，微分人手 geometry 是吧？然后呢，右侧呢是拓扑，是欧拉沉影数，是吧？所以的话呢，这个高斯伯奈特定理是为这两大领域建立了一个桥梁。OK， 所以的话是横跨两大领域，是吧？当然我们知道这个邱先生的话呢是把这个偏微方程和微分几何之间建立了桥梁。OK。这都是历史上的名师。那么在陈先生之前的话呢，人们只研究所谓的局部的微分几何。那陈颖申之后呢才是全局微分几何，是吧？大域微分几何。核心就是把代数拓扑与这个局域微分几何相结合，是吧？所以这里我们可以看到这个同轮群诱导的这个映射度的概念是非常有用的。OK。Okay, then, so now we know how to compute, homology groups. But then, how can we compute cohomology group? So here is the computation method. So given a genus G closed triangle mesh, so we compute the cut graph. Okay, then from cut graph, we calculate the homology basis. Then for each gamma I, okay, then we cut the surface.Along gamma I, we get an open surface with two boundary components. Then we define a zero form or function. Okay, so on one boundary equal to one, on all the other vertices equal to zero. Then we take the derivative, okay, for such kind of function. Then we get a closed, okay, one forms, which form the basis for the first cohomological group for the surface.OK， 所以呢，我们知道如何计算下同调群的基底，那么如何算上同调群呢？说假如呢，给定一个曲面，然后我们先算它下同调群的基底。哎，一共有二几个是吧？是 gamma one、gamma two 和。gamma 突击，然后的话呢，对于任何一个 gamma i， 我们把曲面这个沿着 gamma i 切开 ，OK， 假设这个是 gamma i 是吧？切完之后的话呢，我们得到一个这个开放的曲面是吧？有两个边界，这两个边界的话呢，一个是 gamma i 负是吧？一个是 gamma i。正，然后呢，我们定义一个函数 f 是吧 ？fi 呢是从顶点 OK 到 R 的一个映射是吧？这个 fi 呢限制在gamma i 正上等于正一，就是说在这些顶点上恒为正一是吧？然后呢，它在其他地方恒等于零 OK， 在其他顶点上等于零是吧？OK， 有了这个零 form 之后的话呢，我们定义一个 one form 是吧？我们定义 omega i 定义成 df， OK， df i， 所以 omega i 呢作用在 vi vj 上，它就等于 fvj 减掉 fvi， 是 well defined 是吧？那我们看这个 omega i 呢，它限制在 gamma i 加上。是恒为零的 ，omega i 呢，限制在 gamma i 减上，也是恒为零的，所以这个 omega i 的话呢，是实际上可以定在原来的曲面上 ，OK。那这些 omega 一、omega 二到 omega 2g 就构成了这个 h1 的一个基底， 所以这是上统调弦的一个算法。Okay.
Okay, so today we cover the fundamental definitions and the computational method for surface homology group and the cohomology group. Okay, so everything is based on triangle mesh. So very easy to compute and carry out using a C++. So next time we will introduce the direct applications using homology and cohomology, including a fixed point theory, Hopf-Poincaré theory, also the characteristic of fiber bundles. 今天呢，我们大致介绍了这个上下同调的基本概念和算法。然后的话呢，一切都是建筑在三角网格之上，所以非常容易计算。那么下一次的话呢，我们会介绍，上下同调的一些直接应用，包括如何用它来证明不动点定理。如何用它来证明矢量场这个零点的彭加莱霍普夫定理呢？如何用它来定义所谓矢量场的实行类 ？OK， 好，下次我们再见，谢谢大家 ，Thank you，See you next time。